Hi, this is Phil, and I'm here to tell you all about the Capes and Lunatics Patreon. Get early access to all of our interviews, including the monthly Chichester Chats with writer and comic book legend D.G. Chichester, new episodes of classic Capes and Lunatics shows, including The Quantum Zone, This, That, or the Third, and many, many more specials, all completely uncensored. Access starts for $3 a month, full video when you pledge $5 a month. Check out the link in our show notes or go to patreon.com/capesandlunatics. Hope to see you there. Welcome back to the Chichester Chats. It's me, Phil. It's Lilith. And of course, you know who he is. Successful Kickstarter comic creator and Mr. Daredevil Black Armor number one's going back for a second printing, Mr. D.G. Chichester.
Well, guys, it's the late night edition, and I don't know if it's like a special effect you've got going, but I'm hearing like some kind of reverb, like some world wrestling entertainment like thing going on. So that's especially exciting here as we do our late night edition of the Chichester Chats. So good to see you both. Happy Thanksgiving or a little bit after, and it's exciting to be here.
Thank you. All right, and like I said, I had one question I have to ask up front.
Yes.
I think you mentioned it last episode, and I saw it confirmed on social media. This is what I have one question, and then I have a comment about it. But first, I want the answer to the question. What did Mom think of the first issue? What did your mom think of the first
issue? Well, Mom just liked seeing herself. As I said, she grabbed the silver issue, the foil issue, and pushed out the other things out of the way, grabbed it, and she'll never read it. She'll never crack the cover. She was inordinately excited about this whole thing. And then we went to this kind of semi-local comic shop. I had a choice between a couple of them, and I picked this one, which I hadn't really been to before. And it was an okay shop, but it was super low-key. And, I think we cleared the shelves of it. And I think she was just excited by that. But the owner was a little odd, because I pointed out, I said, oh, I wrote this. And I pointed to my little tiny, tiny, tiny name on the cover. I don't think they could have possibly printed it smaller. And his reaction was like, good for you. Good for you. Like, I clearly thought I was delusional or, suffering from dementia or something. So it was just a nice moment. But she loved seeing it. She loved seeing the covers, and she got a big kick out of it.
Oh, no comment.
I kind of hook you up with my guy in Florida. If you ever want to come down to Florida, my guy's like the second biggest in all of Florida. He'll pick you up from the airport. He'll put you up, whatever.
Awesome. Awesome.
Yeah, he's always excited. Always. No matter if you're small or big, artist, uh-huh, whatever, color alert. Yeah, he's a really great guy. And by the way, I am home right now. And I was like, I knew I had to put this on like in the pile. Like, I wasn't going to leave it to chance for the variant. I was like, you got to give me the variant. I don't care about the other one. I got to get the variant. But in my store, which he bought a lot of them, it was like literally all sold out when I got there on that.
That's incredible. That's amazing. I saw there was a variant that had, which was crazy expensive, actually, but for what it was the Bagley cover, which is no logo. I guess that was a variant.
Yeah.
And just the straight up art, which, because I did this signing at a different store way farther out in Connecticut. And they had that one, which I thought was an unusual thing. I couldn't imagine somebody buying that, but I guess somebody will.
Probably to have Bagley sign it, or we'll have everybody else sign it and like
right
it or something like
right,
that.
Right, 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 right. Yep, totally. Or they'll draw the logo on it. So,
Yeah, there was. I saw two or three people in my store when I went in on Wednesday, and I think everyone had it in their pile. So,
Awesome. That's what I want to hear.
I mean, it must have put did numbers. It's already gone back for a second printing. It's not even a week old.
Yes. Yes, that happened. Like, right off the bat. Like,
Shout out to all the reviews I read. This has had a really great...
Oh, yeah.
People have been, like, really happy about this.
I haven't seen one negative thing on it.
Oh, my favorite review so far was...
Wired reprise their review? If not, we have to...
We haven't gotten to them yet. We have to send them a review copy. No. The level set happens early on, you know, when you try to Google yourself and you get like, oh, that's nice. Oh, that's critical. But, you know, they're making some good points. And then, you know, you go 1, 2, 3, and it's the third one is, you know, the worst writer. You know, the editors knew he was the worst writer. The readers knew he's the worst writer. He knows he's the worst writer, you know, and it just keeps going. It's the brazen confidence of the internet. I love.
I'm not gonna say anything specific, but you know, your Google algorithm is your Google algorithm. Maybe you like to be a little self-deprecating because I literally the first 15 reviews I saw in my Google list.
You're totally right. I've got to change. I got to go into incognito mode and do the search from there. You are exactly right.
I'm just saying, Google all knows us a little too well.
it knows us all differently, which is the thing we always forget. Totally.
I saw one lady's review. She said this thing needed more carnage, and I was like, "You shouldn't say that about your son's book."
If I did see a lineup of new titles this week, and we did follow Carnage.
Yes, it was like a new Carnage number one. First, yes,
right next to each other. I said
alphabetical order. Yep.
Phil and Lilith must have set this one up. It was just there. You go.
All right. Before we get to the questions I got, you said you had questions for us.
Well, I thought we'd turn this one around since this is different. This is, you know, I'm not a nostalgia act for the next 4 months, right? I'm like a current kind of like, you know, thing.
Yeah.
And I thought it'd be a little fun to kind of turn the tables on you guys and ask you some questions since you have read this fresh and this is kind of a new thing. So I thought I'd just put this out. First of all, before we talk about, you know, your reactions to it, what were you expecting from this series before you actually went and picked it up? Like, what was your sort of expectations of what this thing was going to be?
I thought it was going to be like a fun... Well, before we actually discussed this, like, previously in the last episode of Chichester Chats, I was thinking it was definitely going to be a little bit more, like, high-tech, kind of like, you know, Tree of Knowledge kind of style. Because that's just kind of that thing.
Interesting.
But then I had to remember, as we were talking, it's like, you know, you have to do this fine line of nostalgia, but also fit it within the continuity that came before you. But, like, kind of like those Wolverine stories, this is what you didn't see in between page 3 and 4 kind of thing.
This all takes place between page 3 and 4 of issues 4 of Tree of Knowledge. Everything happens in there.
I mean, I don't know.
I was definitely hoping for grounded street-level stuff, so.
Yes.
Pleasantly happy.
I mean, I don't know if I had expectations. I just think, in my mind, I really didn't know, but I just like, it'll probably be at least on par with what he wrote back then. But I was just like, no, not in a bad way. But I'm just like, I mean, I think this is like a bigger page count, but I'm like, man, there seems like there's a lot more, seems like a lot more going on in this than like any of the, like, the issues from the 90s. I was like,
and that's saying a lot because the 90s, like, we always joke like the modern comics could never get through the amount of story nowadays as everybody's writing for their trades that they did back in the 90s.
Oh yeah, and I mean, when we did Tree of Knowledge last time, I mean, you packed so much stuff in each issue, but I'm like, man, it seems like, I mean, I don't think you really get, I mean, after he put on this costume, I don't think there was like a ton of interaction with the Kingpin. I'm like, oh, I didn't think we were gonna get Kingpin. We're getting Kingpin already. Yeah.
It's nice little things there. So, so what was your initial reaction in this first read? You guys seemed like you liked it. You dug it.
Oh yeah.
My first reaction, I was like, Sabretooth! Mutants! Oh my God! I would have never thought. Like, that was my first. I was like, I would have never, but it works.
Well, I saw the preview.
Building to tell.
I saw the cover image for issue 2, so I knew Sabretooth was coming.
See, I don't like this spoil myself anymore. I told you, I just let it happen.
Yeah, they sprung all the surprises real early on, like with their.
I wanted to be fresh.
I'm sorry. I got a question. It's like, I mean, were Sabretooth, and I saw an image of Hobgoblin. Were those your choices? Like, they didn't tell,
I was going to ask that. Are we building synergy for something? If you're allowed to say.
Synergy for, how do you mean? Like, you know.
Like, these specific characters? I don't know. And then, like, as you're, like, looking through the ads,
Or were these just guys you're like, I didn't get to play with them the first?
We're not doing some Sinister Six or something like that. You know, I'm not. Sony is not picking this up for Madam Web 2 or, you know, or Craven the angst-ridden hunter or whatever is going on with that thing. It's Craven time. The thing that Devin Lewis, you know, the editor, said kind of early on is he said, why don't you play with things you haven't played with before? And you know, throw him up against some threats that he hasn't had, or maybe
that
he's had them, but he's had
the
them.
Armor,
yeah,
as you
right.
had always pointed out when you brought that arc with the armor into it, because he did have a lot of threats.
Right, like, right. And
you know, it's not just the spandex.
Exactly. As I reinforce every issue this time, you know.
I think it went over people's heads, honestly, the first time.
I think you're right.
Like, very great detail, and it made a lot of sense if people actually would have just not, you know, people, especially comic book nerds, we hate new stuff a lot of times. And, like,
we just
hate it to hate it, you know?
Oh, my God. It's so true. And, but
because
I think,
now it's, like, nostalgic, and it was, like, back then it was controversial, but now it's, like, oh, a nostalgic one.
Wait a minute. We get to see that thing again? Exactly. That's everybody's like, wait, I loved that thing when I was a kid. So, you know, we threw around a lot of different characters and kind of, looked at them, and then just ultimately I decided on the ones. You know, I said these kind of seem like they're the most fun and they're the most and
what would make a good battle, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what are you going to have fun with there? And there's you know, there's more to come. You know, it's not just the two of them. So that was really you know it, like, kind of who can you pick from in all of the Marvel universe that you want to use that isn't going too crazy. And then you know, we threw things around and I sort of made some consideration. I had a long list of things. Ultimately, they weren't, I didn't get as much feedback from them as I wanted in some ways. I sort of wanted a little more help, kind of, what do you think of this? What do you think of that? But I just liked, I hadn't really played with Sabretooth. I hadn't played with Hobgoblin. So those were great things for me to also look at and say, how do I create some different voices, you know, for these guys and have fun with them? Which, when they get together now, next issue, because you'll have both of them, then it gets even more fun. Well, the artist was...
He's just there for the ride. Like, I'll just bring you a story.
No, I mean, he's obviously been a huge part of it. But at the time that I wrote this and wrote the whole thing, I didn't know who the artist was going to be. They had thrown some names around who I still didn't know who that was, you know, but I could look through, you know, some of the people they were talking about. You know, when Netho showed up... It was literally, they just sent me those first 5-6 pages. I think the first thing I saw was that Fall from Grace spread, and it just kind of came out of nowhere. I opened my email and boom, this is the thing I see. And I thought they were just going to get back to me about the rewrites I had done on the plot to get it down from 5 to 4 issues. So I'm waiting for them to kind of give me, you know, a thumbs up that the pacing's right, thinking I'm going to go on to the full script. And instead, the pages are there. So I said, well, I guess we're doing plot script. I guess this is really old school. And he seems to be loving it. You know, he seems
you lucked out because he's so great with this kinetic action.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like Sabretooth was almost like handpicked for him because of the panels that we see Sabretooth in attack mode in. It just chef's kiss. I love it. Especially specifically this one where he's jumping out at you.
Yeah. He's definitely into the whole 90s vibe, if you want to call it that. And he's
with a
just
a little bit of modern sensibility. I find that, like, I didn't know if there was going to be, like, pressure to like try to recreate or capture something, like, make it 90s but with a slightly modern twist. I feel like he really told the line great. Like, he didn't like go out of his way to imitate Scott or anything like that, so that was really appreciated.
He definitely put
his own twist on it, but it feels very 90s in the best way of 90s, like that extreme raw in your face kind of thing.
He totally
nailed that, but in his own way.
Wait till we get to all the you know, slaughtering the children, you know, in the next issue. You know, that's you know, in that when Carnage shows up, you're really gonna love it. You know, it's bad enough that I call it armor now. Now I'm just gonna embrace Carnage and, like, everything's gonna go. The Daredevil clone saga begins. You know,
General Surgeon confirmed.
Exactly. Finally back.
Terror as the cliffhanger of the whole.
Oh yeah.
Spoilers.
Did you see in Punisher, they're bringing back the new Punisher book? David Pappose, who, you know, writes that, was gleefully sent me a message on Twitter. This isn't a spoiler because the cover's out there in previews, but they actually resurrected Shock, the Mr. Fear daughter character from when I
really
me and Scott had done that one issue. And he loved that character so much when he read it when he was a kid that he couldn't wait to bring it back. And well, you're obviously smarter than I ever was because I just moved right past her. So good for you.
Classic Chichester move back.
Classic. I said that. I said, man, good for you. So she's coming back. I don't think Surgeon General is coming back.
But but no, I mean, you're playing this book for us because, I mean, Loth and I love to see Hobgoblin get punched in the face, especially I believe this is the Macindale era. So we love seeing him getting punched in the face.
Yeah, I tried to figure out who the hell's underneath the mask, and the editors couldn't figure it out totally either. So I'm just like, you know what? He's keeping the mask on, and we're just going for full-on pumpkin bombs and you know, batarang thing, batwing blades and whatever. So I'm just going with Hobgoblin.
Nice.
So what makes you, what does it make you, reading this, looking at this, how does it make you think differently, if at all, about this black armor era? Like, does it suddenly change your feeling about that point in time, that there's now this other storyline, that there's this other adventure?
I mean, I'm excited. I was excited for the original stuff. So,
I
no.
I like the street level stuff. Listen, when Matt goes through the ringer, it's like, this is like actually like now a trope. Like, he goes through the ringer, he loses his mind. Like, but this was his first rodeo. And it's like, that's kind of a reaction. Like, he's super traumatized. Like, I totally get everything that you were going for. And I like this story because it's like, unfortunately, it's a timeless story, right? Of trafficking and using, you mm-hmm. know, people, the unseen, you know? So, mm-hmm.
I love the added details. Like, you get the Melvin Potter. I mean, there was no Melvin Potter, I don't think, in anywhere in your run. So it's like you get to play with Melvin mm-hmm. Potter. I like that. You know, more Kingpin. And, of course, you're bringing back one of your old favorites, Strucker, of course, Baron Strucker.
Yeah. I was surprised that he showed up, too. But,
It's where the story took you.
Well, it's kind of, you said it's around the Tree of Knowledge, right? So, I mean, that's
there's some he's shown up and he's but he gets I get to play with him in a little bit of a different way. So I'm he's got some good scenery chewing, you know, coming up in issue 2 and 3 and wherever he shows up, really. But So how, you know, I've read these interviews, I've watched these podcasts with this Chichester character. He's extremely critical of his own work. So how does this compare to his earlier work in your mind? What is different or better or worse?
I think don't take this person. I think it's better. It really shows how you've matured and seasoned as a writer. Like,
thank God, Lilith. Thank God.
I still see the Chichester there. Like, it's not gone or anything, but it's like, it's just matured, and I really enjoyed it. Like, I love seeing that progression.
Mm-hmm.
Because some writers get stilted, and they don't know how to take advice and things like that. And you've just always been a team player, and it just really shows, like, your growth and your evolution. And
no, I don't take that. Come. I don't take that badly at all. I actually have very, compared to how I pick things apart with you guys, I have very little to pick apart about this one. I worked pretty hard to kind of make it work, and I'm pretty happy with
it. I would have never known you had to size this down at all for the pacing so far.
Oh, God.
Did it more come in like the last 2 issues, or did you have to kind of like tweak all the issues when they told you that it was going to go from 5 to 4?
I had to tweak them all because it was, the whole thing was plotted out, you know, all 5 issues. So it all had to collapse in, and the cliffhangers had to change, you know, so it was all, you know, the story itself didn't change drastically, but the pacing and the cliffhangers, and there were scenes in 2 that came into 1 and that sort of thing. So, and there were, you know,
an extended editor's cut. Who do we talk to about that?
I could probably find the scripts, but all told, I mean, I think that, I think it's, I think how it works now is great. You know, I think it's fine. I liked the pacing before because there were moments that I liked things to breathe a little bit more, you know, and it was almost giving, another beat to introduce or reintroduce some characters, you know, this Juan character, you know, that he's dealing with, who, you know, continues to be important throughout the story. It was nice to kind of give him a little bit more space to kind of get to know Murdoch or Jack Batlin or whatever. And just little things like that maybe it was almost for me, if nothing else, to kind of gracefully reinsert some things. But, you know, once we had to kind of condense it down, and then the editors gave me some notes on what they were thinking. They didn't get a chance to get in and do as much redlining as they wanted. They did a couple pages of redlining, and then they just basically gave me, like, basically, we want this. We want more Daredevil earlier, and we want... And it's like, I got it. I know what you want, and I was able to kind of accommodate it and not feel like, you know... It put more pressure on Netho by the time Netho showed up, you know, because he wasn't part of that. He wasn't assigned to the book yet. So by the time he got into it, you know, he was picking this thing up that then became very, you know, it was a much tighter story and he had a lot more he had to carry. But he also makes a lot of, you know, he makes a lot of decisions. I write it and I'm pacing it out in my head saying, okay, that's like six panels. You know, and then he decides, no, it's 9 panels. No, it's 12 panels. You know, so it's like, dude, go off and do whatever thing that you want to do to make it awesome, because you're clearly, you know, you've clearly got the skills. So I'm not going to hold him back from there. But I do sometimes say, what are you doing? You're like, you know, you're.
I'm just excited. I mean, I think it looks like we're going to get more with the supporting characters like you created for Jack Batlin, like Randy and Lamar and everyone. And even like,
I know.
And the Karen storyline, I mean, they kind of just dropped out when you left. I'm like, are we going to tie up that Karen storyline?
Not here. I mean, I'll give you that much of a
are we hinting at sequel miniseries?
No, nothing. No, there's no, I know of nothing. Beyond
official, okay,
not even unofficial. You know, reintroducing those characters or just having the touch base on a Karen or an Elektra or that kind of stuff just felt appropriate to me, at least. Like I'm coming into this world, and I tried to kind of navigate it without going down some rabbit hole of like it wasn't about my past stories or anything. I wanted to tell this story, but it did feel like. You should acknowledge certain things about this guy's existence in life.
Yeah.
And they were there. And as you said, Lilith, you know, I don't know what people did. I guess they did nothing, you know, except let's kill her. Right.
I know you're so tempted, Phil. Not here though. Not
here. But you know, there were little pieces that you could play out. And it also worked well for me to then start to think about, all right, what are the issues that Matt's going through that aren't a delusion about his identity, but that he is struggling with? All right, these people I'm close to, but I can only get so close. And what does that mean? And that led then into the scene with Randy, who now suddenly becomes kind of a real character. You know, I sort of had forgotten about Randy, actually, like mostly. I obviously had some intention for her the way I was setting her up, but I hadn't really thought about her as a character until I started rereading these things with this in mind. And then suddenly she became a real character, but part of making her a real character was that acknowledgement of, well, I'm still obsessing over Karen and I'm still obsessing over Elektra and I'm still like this. But then there's that scene where he has to kind of make a choice, right? You know, he has to give her up or give them up or give up what he is to a certain extent to kind of move on. And that was just that sense of, all right, this is a natural progression. This feels really good. This feels like the characters are telling me what to do, which was a fun way to explore this world again.
Oh, yeah. No, I commented. Yeah, I mean, you saw I commented, I think, on your Facebook. I'm like, it felt like the 90s, but even better. And we got the signature Chichester Daredevil scene in this, too. You know, the old, I'm going to drop this engine block on you. I will drop this engine block on you.
That was a ball to write. I was afraid he was going to make me cut that scene when they started to kind of like, you know, when we had to cut it down. And I said, Devin, no, you can't let me, you can't have me drop the Kingpin scene. He said, no, I want you to move it from here to here. And it's like, no, you keep it. I mean, it's in many ways, it's a pointless scene, but to me, it's so much fun.
One good push and they fall.
Not as forgiving. Yeah, there's lots, you know, it was fun to do it because there's lots of little, I felt little nods without it being, if you read the stuff and you like the stuff before, it's there, but you don't have to know it, I don't think, to kind of get into this. So where do you think it goes from here? What are you guys looking forward to kind of seeing?
More fights. I'm sorry. The fights were so good.
Oh, there's more fights. Oh my God. There's more fights. There is much pain to come. There is much pain to come.
I just can't wait for the last issue when we get some kind of like subtle like jab to Warren Ellis.
No, I didn't do anything.
Sure hope nothing happens to this costume.
This costume will never be broken. Yes.
With the last scene, like we should have like, you know, a post credit scene with like somebody with the magic scissors, like, you know, like just this person in the shadows. These scissors can even cut through biomimetic material, you know. It's like, and then it's the Surgeon General, right? You know, into the shadows. And there it is. The scalpel that can cut
through. The magic scalpel, yep.
The magic scissor scalpel. They were surgical scissors. That's now we know where they came from.
I'm just curious how this ends, because I mean, you're weaving this through here so far, because I'm like, well, you can't like, you know, you can't put him back to Matt Murdock. So it's like, where are you going to end this?
And it has to stay in this world, which was the worst and maybe best thing. Right. You know, suddenly when it's like, okay, we're doing this. And then I think I said to you guys, when you first talked about this, like, I wrote myself into this corner, never thinking it was going to be a corner, but now it's a world you have to work with. You know, you have to work with the Lamars or the Stithies or the Randys, and you have to balance the Jack Batlin thing, even though it's a little bit of an awkward contrivance, and you have to sort of not, but you know, so far he's okay. I mean, he's.
Yeah, but we get to see more of Hell's Kitchen and make Hell's Kitchen feel more alive, which I think is a lot of things people forget. Especially in modern storytelling, like the city itself is a character, and how these characters interact within this. Every city you live in is different, right? Like,
right. There's a small city, right.
A big city, especially like Hell's Kitchen and like right. in New York itself, and what that means, and the people that you interact with. Like, even from like, you know, Upper Manhattan, you know, Upper East Side, so like, you know, Midtown, you're going to have different interactions with different people.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny watching Netho do certain things, because I lived in Hell's Kitchen during that time. And so, you know, I try to give indications in the plot of certain things. In some places, he's just making his best guess for things of a 90s version of New York. But it all works, I think, you know,
it's okay.
Yeah, he's so enthusiastic, and, you know, he brings so much to the page that it all balances out. No, I didn't even think about doing like a Warren Ellis thing or any, like the only,
I used to be like us.
I know. Yeah. No, he's
no, a, you know, but I used to do so many in jokes and so many things here. And, you know, the only in jokes now is they're not even in jokes. I mean, there's little nods and references and there's like a line, and there's a line in four that you'll recognize that kind of like is an echo back to something, but it's just a way to kind of, you know, I don't know, mirror certain things. I put one in joke in there for my kid, you know, where I reference the school he goes to, like in issue two, I think, which was just a place where suddenly I had an opportunity to talk about something. I said, do you want me to put your school in here? He's like, so that was fun.
And did I see a preview for issue two? We're getting a certain guest star.
I don't know. What did they preview in issue?
I thought I saw an image of Spider-Man, so I...
Oh, yes. There's a good... Yeah, there's a fun Spider-Man scene. You know, and again, that was an editorial sort of suggestion of just throwing things out there that I think what was the best part of the editorial conversations here was they opened up, I think, the opportunities for me. You know, in a lot of ways, I always sort of felt like Daredevil had to be just here narrowed in. I don't think, you know, I would play with little bits and pieces.
So much has changed. People have caught up to how great Daredevil is. Yeah. And not, like, so stingy about it.
That's what I was going to say. Daredevil's more of a, like, a known name after, like, the Netflix series and everything.
Yeah. 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 So you know, it was fun to kind of, like, say, hey, let's use this sort of feeling that the Marvel Universe is a bit, you know, bigger. I mean, not that I didn't play with parts of it before, and I used Spider-Man before, but there was a nice place there, and there's a nod actually to the Surgeon General, maybe in the Spider-Man scene. Now that you mention it, you'll recognize it when you get to
oh,
it.
Oh yeah,
But that was a ball. It was fun. It was like, you know, and he gets a nice little armored dig in there as well. Poor Matt.
Everybody can have a symbiote, although now that's not true. But back then,
poor Matt, you know, takes a lot of armor abuse in this story in more ways than one. So,
all right, are you ready for some questions?
I am. Now it's all yours.
All right. All right. On Twitter, yes. Kim Scametal had two questions. The first one was, if Marvel asks you and Netho to return for another Black Armor story, do you have another concept in mind?
Oh, yeah. Right away. I mean, I don't know if they buy it, but I have one. Yeah, and if they didn't buy that one, we'll come up with another one. I think that would be a lot of fun. I mean, it would be an extraordinary amount of fun to work with him again. I mean, I know that he's... I mean, just from what I've heard and the buzz and things, I think he's going to be unattainable. I think he's going to be rightly much more in demand. And I know he's working on another series after this for Marvel. So they've already kind of jumped on him. And I think a lot of people are going to be signing him up. I think he's going to be a really hard get. But if there was a chance to kind of work with him again, I would do so in a heartbeat.
Oh, thanks. Oh, so there is a concept in mind. Yes.
There's always a concept.
Oh, yeah. Doesn't mean they'll like the concept.
Come on.
I read this one review, which was positive, before the Google algorithm kicked in, Lilith. And but they sort of said, you know, it's a really good effort. It's a really, you know, solid story, you know, but it's a little they didn't use the word ordinary, but they were sort of saying, you know, human trafficking and, you know, street level
grounded,
mystery.
What we like in Daredevil.
Grounded. It's like, they got no idea what happens.
Oh, he's lulling us into a false sense of security.
They have got no idea. Like, basically, I said to the editorial team, I said, when I look back and I sort of, if I analyze Fall from Grace and Tree of Knowledge in a sort of way, they're really basically two, excuse my language, bug fuck stories. I mean, they're really kind of a little bit off the chain, and I think maybe that's where the armor maybe has its best uses. So anybody who thinks this is an ordinary story or in any way, shape, or form, man, it goes places very quickly.
Oh, nice.
All of which is right there. All of which is right there in the first issue. So.
Just gotta look for it.
Teasing us.
Media literacy, people. Media
That's exactly literacy. It. Exactly.
All right. I don't know if you answered this one already, but what was the most fun moment to write in this first issue?
I think that Kingpin scene. I think that was just a. I mean, there was a lot of fun things to do, but I think that was a ball to sort of do it and just get that back and forth play and you know, abuse Wilson, you know, in that kick the kingpin when he's down, and you know, that dynamic was just a lot of fun.
Well, those two are probably always fun to write, but I mean, especially in this era, it's probably even more fun because it's like, you know, Kingpin thinks, oh, I can just, you know, BS this guy, you know, because it's a new guy, and Matt's just like, I know all your tricks, you know.
Right. That was fun, and you know, then it was also like there's. To me, at least, you know, the fun little kind of call forward, even like the mayor joke, you know.
Was, oh, yeah.
It's a nice little bit. Mayor. And you know, I think that, yeah, exactly. Oh, you know, it's like Back to the Future. You know? Goldie Wilson, you know, whatever it was. You know, Mayor Wilson, you know. It's just that, you know, there's fun things to do when you can play with like where you know things are going to go, where it's the story's not dependent on it. Or anything like that, but I found that whole scene a lot of fun to put together.
oh, I can't wait for the Spider-Man, because even Lilith and I were saying, we'd love to see some Spider-Man from you, too. You know, just...
we're just manifesting. Don't mind us.
Yeah, yeah. C.B. Cebulski. yeah. Give this man Amazing Spider-Man. But no, I did, like, you only barely touched, you know, you had, like, that two-issue arc with Spider-Man back in the day. I can't wait to see what you do with Spider-Man next issue.
Yeah, and it's, you know, it's another small scene, but it's a fun scene, and it's, you know, it just helps advance the story a little bit in a certain direction. I could have probably handled it in different ways, but it's a nice way to kind of connect it to the Marvel universe, and it also expands this black armor, whatever you want to call it, you know, somebody called the black armor era, but you know, it just widens out the feeling that I kind of had doing this, that, because everyone's going on, well, where does this take place exactly? Is this like takes after Fall from Grace and before Tree of Knowledge and after Tree of Knowledge, whatever. It's like, the only important thing is that there were more stories that happened in that timeline. And that's where this sort of like cracks it open a little bit more, where you could start to say, all right, he did interact with more than what we saw, which just kind of creates opportunity for not even for me necessarily, although I should be the first one they call, of course, but just, you know, anybody to play with it, right? To kind of play in this space. You know, I think I said on Twitter, I said, geez, maybe Melvin just went and made another costume and kept it in the back closet. You know, he made the backup one. So actually you could like totally, you could totally, you know, undermine the whole ripping the thing apart.
So it could, so it could show, or it could even show up in the present day. You know, it's in a, Warren Ellis proof safe, you know, or something. Right. Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, this package arrives in the mail. It's like from the dry cleaner. Yeah. From Melvin, like found this, you know, with the ticket.
Post office. Oh, we finally found you. Here's your package from 1995.
Exactly. Yeah, return address, Melvin Potter, you know, 2021 Guardian Way, you know.
But I think I figured this out. He said, you don't know where this story's going. It's going to be crazy. And he doesn't want to pin down specifically when it takes place. I'm guaranteeing you, by issue 4, we're getting System Crash. I'm telling you.
Finally, they come back.
Please be true. Please be true.
And then I kill them off the next page. You know, once more. You know, just to...
You know, all those ninjas he came up with in from Fall from Grace and then System Crash. It's just a big fight scene.
Gotta justify that armor, Phil. We gotta justify that.
That's it. We gotta do it. Yeah. We gotta do it.
So besides Sabretooth and Hobgoblin, are there other
Yeah. I'm looking at a picture right now of four of a complete madcap thing that Netho has done it's just one panel and it's insane enough as it is. So yeah, there's lots of other of bodies and psychopaths, you know, at play.
I mean,
here.
Some not short for those.
Some expected, some unexpected, some just so weird. They're either going to make people laugh out loud in a good way, or they're going to just think this is the stupidest thing ever. But you know, I just sort of went with it and just, you know, kept unspooling it and saying, well, this is fun. And where can Matt not only confront these things, but use them, use his brains to kind of outwit certain things. And, you know, we've talked about this before. I think that's where I enjoyed the character was not just the brute force and the senses, but also I liked him to kind of, I don't know, scheme a little bit. You know, he's a bit of a schemer, I think. So you know, in retrospect, I could have had him scheme more in the Last Rites Fall of the Kingpin story, but that whole story is a scheme, right? He seduces this and he gets this and he makes that thing blow up and
everyone's scheming this. In that story. Nick Fury's like, let him scheme. I'm scheming. Yeah. Let him scheme.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
More questions?
I have another question. No, go ahead. You go, Phil.
It's not a question, but a few days ago we got a comment on the YouTube. No, I just wanted to bring this up because you are always saying, oh, we got so much crap back in the day for that costume and stuff.
Oh, we did.
Somebody commented on the one episode we did when they announced this at Comic-Con.
Yeah.
He said, ironically, the red suit is my least favorite one besides the Shadowland run Daredevil suit. Daredevil's armor is my favorite one.
I've seen that a lot.
I know. He says, I remember seeing it in issue 321 of Fall from Grace, and then in that one of those amazing Spider-Man issues, you know, from back then.
Right.
Yeah, but he said that's his favorite costume is the black armor. So,
and it's one of the coolest Daredevil toys for sure.
It's totally.
I'm waiting
the coolest
on the Funko Pop, honestly. So
I always say,
is there a Funko Pop? Is there? Do they have one yet?
I haven't seen one. I've been hunting. I haven't seen one. No, no. Well, maybe now. Maybe now.
You can always.
Maybe now there might be.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. The funniest thing is, you know, I'm going to GalaxyCon. This coming weekend, there, you know, in Columbus, Ohio. But they said they're doing a Black Armor variant cover for GalaxyCon. So I was like, oh my God, that sounds really great. Look it up. There's no Black Armor on it. It's a beautiful illustration of classic Daredevil, but the only thing that's on it that's Black Armor is on the back cover. It looks like, there's the
title
logo.
Yeah.
But I don't understand, like, I'm looking at it. I said a note to Netho. I said, where's the black armor? Am I missing something? Like, you know, it's just, anyway.
It's the latest craze.
It's the latest craze.
It's like putting gluten-free on Oreos. It's always been gluten-free.
I have not seen it in person. Maybe there's a kind of a variant, you know, mezzo tint, you know, thing where you
lenticular
tilt it one way.
Cover!
It's a lenticular.
Oh, that'd be great if it changed from red to the black armor. Oh, that would be great. Yeah.
Now that would be cool.
That's what we need.
I will.
I mean, we already got the foil.
Yes.
I gotta go. Yeah, I gotta get the foil. Yeah.
The foil is cool. The foil is cool.
And I'm sure you know nothing about any of the plans, but I was gonna say they need to I want to see like Netho's art on like posters. I want to see merchandise, T-shirts.
That's a poster right there.
Yeah.
I mean, there's
so
actually,
many of these pages are actually pretty cool posters.
Oh yeah.
I bought page 17 of issue 3, and when you see it, you'll know why.
All right, kids. Surgeon General confirmed.
Exactly. The blades are out. But yeah, his stuff is just killer, and he's having a ball. I mean,
It definitely shows.
Oh yeah, yeah, I definitely won. Yeah, merch and posters, and that's what I'm saying.
Can we get like a pseudo copy of Street Legal as well?
I know.
I just need a little frame.
I don't, you know, let this. This is maybe how I've also matured as a writer, Lilith. Like I. When I came up with that, I patted myself on the back. I thought that was like, all right, I've solved it. I solved the whole, like, how does Matt, like, get his, you know, his lawyer thing on and have fun with it. I just enjoyed that moment there. But, you know, just coming up with this whole little conceit. And did you pick up on the one Saul Goodman joke in it?
Phil, that's your department.
Oh, no, I don't know if I did. Oh.
Tell me somebody said Saul Goodman.
Yeah.
Oh man, and I missed it.
It's in the when he meets the cruddy landlord and his goons in the you know.
I'm on that page right now. Hold up.
And he literally says, "It's all good, man."
Oh, I love Better Call Saul. Oh.
I always make that joke, and I'm like, that can't possibly really be in the show, right? It is. It's actually in the show. Okay.
Oh yeah, it's all good, man. Oh jeez. I think we've said that before. We're like, you know, what if someone wrote Matt Murdock like he was Saul Goodman, you know?
That's basically what Jack Batlin.
Yeah, pretty well so without the law degree. Yeah, well,
not quite so smarmy, but
yes.
No. His heart's in a much better place. Yes.
Oh, but I'll tease everyone. Hopefully, next episode we'll have a special guest because I did reach out to Netho to see if he wanted to join us.
Awesome.
Yeah. So he might join us next time because I didn't even know what time zone he was in. He's like 2 hours ahead of us. So, like, if we do a Saturday morning, it'll probably be easier
than tonight.
Yeah. But so, yeah, he may join us next time. Because I wrote to him and he says my English isn't the best. He's like, but I'll give it a shot. He's like, let's, you know. Like,
yeah, that would be awesome. That would be, just give the floor over to him and let him go on about it. So
how difficult is it to work with Dan?
you know, well, I'm sure he'd have much to say. He's had to suffer through these plots, you know. But he's like I said, he's packed in stuff, his storytelling, you know, he's making the choices, and he's delivering, like beyond delivering. I mean, it's just great, great stuff. Great, great moments. There's a great, and it's like there's these weird, not weird. There's these brilliant little details when you get to, I'll say Strucker's, dining room. It's not quite a throne room, but it's like, but his dining room, you know, in issue two, just look on the wall. There's this painting, you know, that he put in there. Netho just put in on his own of Strucker, you know, just a self-congratulatory, you know, Strucker painting, which is so perfect, you know, for Strucker. But he just he just came up with that on his own and just sort of like put it there. It's like, my God, that's like brilliant.
Narcissistic,
you
know, just, maniac.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like he went to the trouble, like, you know, of yes. Of
and
just,
they killed the painter probably.
Yeah. It just, you know, no, I must have this painting on the wall. So it's just great little things. There's this bit I'm looking at right now from four where it's this, I did a couple of those like young Matt Murdock scenes and he just has this great body language, you know, of him looking kind of uncomfortable and nervous. And it's just the little touches that, you know, make it feel so, you know, so effective and so alive. The character's alive. The city's alive. And I think, you know, he's obviously, the guy's been working in comics for 10 or more years and has done a lot of work. But, you know, these are the kind of things that catapult somebody, right? You know, Predator is not Daredevil, right? So that'll be the thing that, you know, his quality of work is suddenly not probably jumped. I think he's probably always been really good, but like the people at Marvel or whatever else or something, they'll look at him very differently. And you know, I think more power to him for that.
Oh no, the art in this is great. I mean, it's modern comic art, but again, it's not like it's not taking me out where I'm like, oh, this doesn't look like 90s Daredevil. I mean, it's evoking that time. So it's, you know, yeah. I said, I want that poster. Cause what I'll do, I'll hunt down another Fall from Grace poster. Cause I had to hang my last one when I was a kid, but I mean, I'll take stuff down off that wall. I want a Fall from Grace poster and I want a new, Netho, black armor right next to it.
Right, 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 right. Yeah.
No, well, Marvel.
Super cool. Mm-hmm.
I mean, to bring this bring this episode all back around, I saw my mom was watching. Hi, Mom. everyone's mom's involved in this episode.
It's a family affair. It's a family affair.
Yeah, but yeah, I cannot wait for the rest of these, and I want them all now. But I'm like, man, then maybe it's better. It's once a month.
Yourself.
Yeah, it's better because I mean, otherwise it would be here and gone. Boom, you know.
You know, if they come out with this a year and a half ago when everything you could binge, that would be fine. But now we're pacing the stories out like the old days. The episodes come like once a week, once a month or whatever. So, and that's kind of fun. I think that's, I mean, obviously I know where it's going, so I don't have to worry about it. But I mean, I hope I know where it's going. Although I struggled mightily last night over one scene of like, how the hell do you script this? What did you do? What did you do to yourself? But no, it all worked out fine. But I think that's fun. I think it's fun to kind of have that anticipation. I'm glad you guys are feeling that way. I really, you know, I respect your opinion. So, you know, you've done me a great,
I was just, you know, worried service. About people's reaction. Cause there's so many like nostalgia minis out now. Like, you know how it's like, oh, superhero fatigue. I feel like it was a lot of nostalgia, and I saw the best compliment. I don't know if you feel like it's a compliment, but it's like, they were comparing it to World's Finest, where it's like, it's really great, like throwback stories with modern mm-hmm. sensibility, but not too much modern.
I mean, that's Mark Waid. That's a good comparison. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like that perfect blend of nostalgia, but like also like not too continuity of what comes after, but like just, you can just enjoy it.
Mark gave me a thumbs up on this. I sent Mark an early copy and he gave me a thumbs up. So I was like, all right, it's okay then.
You two have so, a lot in common, actually. We've interviewed him a couple times. He's self-deprecating as well.
Yeah, he was very kind to take a look at it, and then he sent me back a really nice note, and so that was all right. That's good.
But I was gonna say, yeah, if you need any script advice on these issues, yeah, just reach out. Me and Loaf will be more than happy to just tell us what's going on, and we'll give you some advice.
My mother will roll over in her grave if I actually put my English degree to you.
Wait a minute! I got to use it now. I can.
She has a degree in everything
now. Finally, can use it. So how would you? How would you? My last question to both of you. So, how would you describe this in one line? Or two, you know, or whatever. How would you, what would be the way you'd sort of like, you know, sell it to somebody else?
Fantastic.
Less than a line even. You see, I would have bleeped, you bleep me out when you edit this later. So, you know, it's all clean.
No, it's like, I again, it's like.
If a devilish good time.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yes.
What was that one? What was that
one? A devilish good time.
A devilish good time. You've been holding on to that one for a while. That's good.
It's been in the pocket, yeah.
It's been there, yeah.
Wait a minute, I can finally use it. Hell of a good time. So yeah, I was hell like, of a good devilish.
Time. Good, nice.
Good for the old nice. Fans. Good for a brand new fan.
Yeah.
No, it really is. It though. Is. Like, I think this is definitely, you're going to definitely see some spikes in trades, I think, of the old trades. People are going to, if they didn't read it before, or they
maybe Marvel. Maybe Marvel will reissue some trades too for some new.
Well,
trades.
They're at cool yes, Jit, saw that they Mithra, were. Who you know runs ManWithoutFear.com, who actually I'm talking to tomorrow and get his review. But he sent me the upcoming previews or sales. I guess they are coming out with Fall from Grace and Root of Evil reissued in June. So. Somebody must be thinking exactly that. Like there must.
Well, you know, I mean, a second printing is just like kind of a no-brainer at this point. But they, I think yeah. they had faith in it before. Like they kind of know. They can kind of.
The editor, you know, the Daredevil office
for.
Seemed to have faith in it, and they seemed, you know, very hyped. You know where it was kind of going, and just the vibe about it. But you don't know. I mean, you don't really know until it happens, and then you start to. Thing. I mean, actually, you know, I'm not even going to say that. I cannot. I felt very confident about it, you know, from the moment that we really started to bring it together, and then the artwork and everything kind of coming around it, and then the scripting on it, you know, felt really good. And in the '90s vibe of like everybody's got says the absolute perfect thing at the perfect time to the perfect effect. You know, they're. There's just some, I don't know. I just think there's some great lines in this story that just not even in this, you know, there's some good bits in this one, but there's some moments that the way that Netho did the end of number two, he made a choice at the end, that took, like a splash and it opened, you know, he took what it was supposed to be a panel and turned it into a splash. And then that changed like how I was going to handle the last line of the issue. And then it just became like this thing that was like about 500 times more powerful and stronger. It's like a cliffhanger. If that doesn't work for you guys, then just cancel this show.
You're
altogether.
Dead inside. You're yeah. Dead
yeah.
Inside.
I'm dead inside. It's just such a great lead into three from the cliffhanger from two.
So what you're saying is we love this issue, but we ain't seen nothing yet. Is that what you're saying?
Oh yeah. Oh, okay. My God. Oh my God. And then you get to three. Three is like, just yeah, it's actually exhausting. I was exhausted by the time I finished scripting three. I mean, not because it wasn't, I'd actually script it really easy, but it's so like it's like it is. It was well, it, how do we get all this
the penultimate
in one
issue after all
in 20 issues or 20 pages? How did we do this? I said it just doesn't seem possible. But you know, there's like a shit ton of stuff going on. It's just a straight brutal, like, you know, run but you know, still has some good, you know, really good moments of character and introspection and, you know, paying off some things and time for the Surgeon General, of course, you know, make her, you know, and
I'm just looking forward to Carnage. I just feel like he's gonna show up.
Can you imagine? that's he's gonna pull out an issue four.
That was the changeover that you can't
gets his head ripped off.
You can't use this character you really want to, but you know, You have to pull Strucker out of the issue and Carnage takes over. You know, that's
I was thinking about that the other day. Could you imagine, Lil Fitter's just a scene where Matt's just like beating. I mean, again, Dan's not the guy who says and they fight for five pages, but I could just imagine a page or two of just Matt wailing on Carnage, you know.
It's like, that's the red. It's my red.
Exactly. You know? There could only be one guy in all red around
exactly,
here.
Exactly. Exactly. So no, fun. Well, really good.
I enjoyed this. Yes. I can't wait to see what's more. Like I said, it was all sold out, and I wanted to buy more so I could give to my friends for Christmas.
Well, if so you find more, I know. I've got to find. I went to the signing like on Saturday at this store somewhere in Connecticut, and I did pick up a couple extra copies just so I would have some. But I should have actually bought a couple more to thinking about that. But
they'll have to settle for second printing. Oh well,
I'll have to. Maybe I'll find some in Columbus. You know, maybe they're not quite cleaned out at the con.
Yeah.
Or I'll take them from somebody. Somebody will hand them to me like, you know, can you sign this? And I'll just keep it. And I'll just be like one of those people.
Is that early December?
That's next weekend. That's coming.
Third, fourth, fifth.
This right now, like whatever. Okay. I leave on Thursday. The con is Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So
all right.
December 1, 2, and 3. This is our announcement section. If you're in the Columbus, Ohio area,
Tyler,
come see me.
Go meet Chichester.
Come see me at GalaxyCon, Ohio, wherever the convention center is in Columbus. And I'm sure it's the Greater Columbus Convention Center, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Come by for autographs and black armor conversation.
Oh, yes, 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 yes. All right. I don't have any other questions. I don't know if you do, Lilith, but I did want to say this is what we were talking about when you jumped on. Axles Infernal has been fully funded.
Yes.
I can't remember the last time I was so happy to see a charge on my credit card. I'm like, yes.
And thank you guys for your support there and doing a program devoted to that and helping push it and promote it. I know that was a big part of helping it kind of get over its hurdles and get in front of people, and definitely made use of that, programming and that conversation. So thank you again for the time on that. And we're working hard now to bring it together. And if anybody backed it, and I know you guys, did, the dramatic reading will be scheduled sometime in the next few weeks, probably. And you'll all get an email about that.
Oh, nice. Nice. All right, and before we go, I think I saw, issue 2 of Black Armor's coming out, I think the 20th?
December 20th. Yeah. A perfect
Christmas present.
It was
yes.
Thanksgiving, now it's
yes,
Christmas.
It is a perfect holiday. The last issue comes out my mother's birthday.
Oh, nice.
So we might actually get it back into a comic store a second time.
I told you this.
I told
came
you.
Came along
yes.
at the perfect time.
Yes.
Oh, they gotta put another shiny cover on number 4 then. Oh.
I know.
Exactly.
She doesn't want some ordinary thing. The next one is out right before Christmas, the 20th.
So yeah, kids. So kids, send in your questions, because you see the man will answer your questions.
I will. Let's go for it.
And like I said, hopefully next time we'll have Netho too. So
that would be so cool. That would be really awesome. Yep. Yeah, and then he can rag on me, and I don't have to rag on myself. We'll go from there.
We'll get Guys. Fabian for that.
Yeah. Fabian's only rags on me about Epic Comics, I think. my pretentious, why can't sales support, Epic? No.
They just go, then say, what did you say, Mr. NFL Super Pro? What?
What have you done lately? Deadpool? I mean, really, did that catch on? Anyway, guys, thanks for the special late night edition. This has been fun. I'm glad we were able to do this in advance of everything else.
Yes.
And so close to this thing coming out. And this will be fun for the next couple months by continuing to get this real time effect of what's happening.
And again, I mean, I'm going to turn this around. I want to post this for tomorrow. So yeah, go see him at in Columbus this weekend, right? This weekend.
Yes, totally. Yep, totally. I'll see you guys. Anybody, come by and see me there.
Go get your autographs.
Flights go well. I'm there on time. It's not like going to Austin that took me 16 hours to get there. So I'm hoping
That's a little closer. It's a little closer than Texas.
Yeah, but 16 hours to Austin, that's bad by anybody's estimation. That was a long travel day. So, yeah, Columbus will be simpler. All right, folks, take it easy. Have a good evening.
All right, thank you, sir.
All righty. Be well. Bye.